Good morning, good morning, Hawaii. We're so happy to be with all of you. You know, in my heart, some of the most wonderful people and entertainers have come out of Hawaii. And I've been here for 35 years. And I've been so privileged to meet many, many, many entertainers. And the biggest privilege is that they're, most of them, Christians now. And to me, that thrills my heart because I know that I'll see them in heaven one day and they'll still be performing in a beautiful way, Colleen her dancing, and so many people that are and have been entertainers. But I am privileged this morning to bring you an entertainer after my own heart, and his name is Dick Jensen. And good morning, Dick.
Morning. It's good to be here. Thank you.
It's so good to have you. And Colleen and I are so thrilled to be able to talk story with you. But first, you know what? He's got a tremendous story, by the way. Did you know he's called Giant in Las Vegas because of his gigantic performances? I mean, he was the performer. And first, I want to read you a little something. I'm going to take Dick down a walk of a memory lane. And Colleen and I are both going to kind of just cause him to remember some things that we met. Dick and I met about 23 years ago. I figured it last night. And he got saved on January 12, 1983. I was talking to somebody about Dick, and I was going to do his special. And they said, oh, I didn't know Dick was a Christian. I said, he's not only a Christian, he is a man of God. He is a pastor. But I want to back up and I want to explain the first time, Dick, that you were on my Heartlight show. Way back when I did a half hour tape show right here at KWHE. And it was at 6 a.m. in the morning and they were taping it and I couldn't even get up to watch my own show. But we had fun doing that first show, and I want to read to you what I have put in my book about this special man. How I was privileged to have Dick Jensen on one of my very first Heartlight TV shows, June 14th, 1989, where he and I laughed over producing my very first TV blooper. This show was on the air at 6 a.m., a time I could never get up to watch. And I would read my own radio poems and have special guests to talk story. As Dick and I taped our show, all was quiet on the set as I read my poem, Dastardly Dan. I don't know if you remember that. Very quickly, out of the poem section in my folder, I had a folder on my lap, and I read this poem real quickly. It was rather long and maybe a little bit boring to Dick. I don't know, because he was a fascinating person. And his mind just went lickety-split into everything. And he had a wonderful and has a wonderful sense of humor. And every time Dick and I get together, we laugh and laugh. And when we go out to the restaurant with my husband and I, we'd sing all the old songs after we had dinner, right there at the table. And have more fun because I would challenge him, do you remember this song? Do you remember that song? And we'd sing it together. Of course, his voice was a lot better than mine. As Dick and I taped our show, all was quiet on the set as I read my poem, Dastardly Dan, very quickly all over the poem. Then I turned my face to the seated Dick Jensen and blurted out proudly but very wrong, I'd like you to meet my good friend, Jick Denson. Jick Denson. And he looked at me, and I looked at him, and I realized I had made a really big boober, you know, because he is my good friend. How could I call him Jick Denson? And he threw his head back and laughed, and I threw my head back and laughed, and my folder fell on the floor. And we had to start over all again. The whole show. And we looked at each other oddly, and I was taken back by my obvious mistake, and I threw up my hands and my folder fell off my lap, and we threw our heads back and laughed. wait for the fire trucks to go by. Well, of course, we started all over again, and Dick so sweetly suggested with a laugh, Phyllis, why not put it on the end of the credits as your first Heartlight blooper, which I did do. Over 6 years. However, I can't recall any funnier bloopers, I'm happy to say. And we will go into how we met at the cook's house in a little bit. But first, Colleen is going to take you back on a journey through his life. And would you like to start, honey?
Yeah. Hi, Phyllis.
Hi, good morning.
Hi, good morning.
We're back again.
Yes, good to see you and good to be back here again, especially with our special friend and guest, very special guest, Dick Jensen. And
you're getting all teary. Okay, now you got to tell us the story.
Basketball. My wife and I have a code to each other. Okay. As I begin to talk and I get overly emotional,
you just go.
I just do this, which means I cry at basketball games. That's when she takes over and begins talking on my behalf.
Oh, that's a good
that's
one.
Yeah.
That's
so a good while one. We're talking, she just looks at me and she just goes.
What about when you folks both go?
Well, we both be quiet and you let the Lord deal with that.
Yeah. Yes. But I have tremendous memories. And I remember as a very young girl walking the streets of Waikiki, sometimes going to the beach or whatever, but I remember passing by this one nightclub. I think it was white on the outside, not many windows, so you had to peer into the door to really see what was happening, but the music was so electric and the thumping of the beats were so pulling me into this building. I peered in and I saw Dick rehearsing. It was during the daytime, and I'm sure he had shows at night, and just re-talking about all of these times of his beginning, I realized that this was Da Swamp, Da Swamp, where he was performing as one of the first places that
Da Swamp.
Da Swamp.
You
it was hip
hoppin'.
It was originally Honey's Lounge from Kaneohe.
Oh,
that's where Don Ho worked. And when he left and I came in with the rock and roll thing, it changed it to the Swamp. And in those days, you couldn't get in. I mean, 4 o'clock, the place was jammed with GIs and surfers, yeah.
The Swamp.
It was electrifying.
Dick Jensen and the Swamp Man.
It was electrifying. It's something that's indelible in my mind. And
plus the other time, you
yes.
said,
when I was, I was probably in my 20s, not too long after that, I saw him at the Dome with a huge concert that he brought his artists from Las Vegas, the Three Degrees.
The Dancers, yeah.
And the Dancers. And I remember there at the Dome, I pointed to, my boyfriend was with me, Barry Kim, and I pointed at the stage and I said, that's what I want to do. Because I saw these Japanese girls dancing jazz, and I said, that's what I'm gonna do.
That was before you were a professional dancer.
Yes.
So you had an influence on her life before she even started dancing with Don Ho.
And who was the person that was on stage that caused you to say?
Louise Kawabata is the girl that hired me.
A friend, mutual friend of ours, right? And she was the head dancer in my show at that time. And caused her to do it. When she brought the name up last night in our conversation, I said, you won't believe this, but just a week ago, Louise Kawabata walked into my house and just said, how's it?
How many years? That's
30 years.
30 years, wow. That's wonderful. That's where we want to take you back there.
Yes, but he has had such an influence on entertainers here in Hawaii because he brought not only the excellence, but it was so cutting edge. The sound was so bright and electric. The beats were electric, and it just ignited flames in the hearts of entertainers that were growing up at that time reaching for something, and until I saw his show, you know, I didn't really know what I wanted to do. I went to college. I graduated in secondary ed. That wasn't really me.
No, no.
You know, and you have to sometimes see something to really know, and it was his show when he came back from the mainland.
Well,
here.
He was pretty big in, you were pretty big in Las Vegas, I hear. How many years were you there?
Almost 20.
20 years in Las Vegas? I didn't
well,
know that.
What we did was that we did 10 weeks at a time. And so I did maybe two or three times a year.
I see.
But majority of my time was here in Hawaii,
was
on the Oceania.
So you brought back over here to little old dinky Hawaii this great big performance,
well,
the big
at
giant.
At that time, that's before Roy Tokujo came into town with all his million-dollar presentation.
Thank God for Roy.
Yeah, well, I mean, we were cutting edge, as we thought.
Yeah.
But the amount of things that went on in Dome was instrumental. To the entertainment scene.
Wow, you know. And you got into the Dome. But before that, now, you were on the Ed Sullivan Show, right?
He was on all the major, Merv Griffin, Mike Douglas, Johnny Carson, as
Gold
well
Diggers,
as Ed Sullivan, Dean Martin.
Dean Martin's a good one.
Joey Bishop.
And Joey Bishop.
Anybody remember Joey Bishop?
Oh, yes, I have.
Yeah.
And let's roll into that. He said, that's
yes,
ready.
Yes, we have a B-roll.
Yeah.
So let's go take a look at Dick Jensen at the Ed Sullivan Show.
Recording star Dick. Young girls, they do get weary.
So whether it's performing live before millions on the popular Ed Sullivan Show in New York City, or the Johnny Carson Tonight Show from Los Angeles, the giant delivers.
Big
that
sound,
was awesome.
That's how big you were over there. I look
awesome.
At Ed Sullivan, you know, I grew up watching him, and you come out, you are a giant, humongous guy.
It was really something that you're going on to a show that you've only seen with the eyeball as a kid every Sunday.
Yeah,
right.
You watch Tujopo and the mouse and, you know.
Yeah, Topo Chico.
Yeah,
Topo Chico. Yes.
And all of a sudden, you're on that very same stage.
Amazing.
And today we watched David Letterman in that same theater.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay, well, I know when Ed Sullivan introduced you, it was just kind of matter of fact, but after you performed, he was like, come here, and he held your hands. I know they were really impressed. But besides that, not only the singing, but he had such a comedic talent that was really rare. And what do you call those sounds? What do you call that?
Well, the idea was that there was an old friend of mine that goes back to the days of the swamp.
Uh-huh.
His first day in town, he's living next door to the swamp. And he comes down because there's a tidal wave alert, right? That's what he's introduced to Hawaii.
With oh, hello.
He comes running in. What do I do? I said, hang out with us. Okay, we'll have another beer. We're thinking like, wait a minute, there's a tidal wave coming. Yeah, we'll be right in a few minutes. He didn't understand, but he wrote the original Lone Ranger.
Is that
which
right?
What I did in my show when I added the sound effects and all that, so.
I remember the hula hut you did there.
Yeah.
With your gun. I remember now.
Sound effects.
The sound effects were so super. Yeah. It's the second role.
The visual comedy and the sound effects and all of that put together.
Charisma. What's the second
one? We gotta go see that right now.
All right.
A gay bartender.
Yes, I certainly have.
A jive-talking black rapper. Twirling guns. And a cannon exploding is quite an unexpected treat for his audience.
Wow, where did you get those ideas anyway? Did that just pop up out of your imagination?
Yeah, I think one day I was trying to do a different sound. Well, for those of you who know, I was in the BC world that time, and I came into the club one afternoon with a terrible hangover, and I said, you know, let me just see if I can make some sound.
Yeah, BC club means before Christ, right? Okay.
So all of a sudden I'm doing these sound effects, and I went, whoa, I think I can do this in this comedy routine. And therefore was born the Lone Ranger.
I know, but you were Steve Martin and didn't know it.
Were you able to do it that well the first time?
No.
You had to.
I mean, the first time that I went, I wonder how that would do. How about this? And trying to find the place on the mic that would be that way to do the sound. You know? Then I realized that I couldn't do with a round microphone.
Oh.
I had to do what they call the 545F, and it's a pencil mic.
Oh.
And that's the only way I could do the sound.
Oh.
But here it was, you try something and doesn't work, try something else.
Fabulous. Yes. You have a creative mind.
Well, and that became a signature for me.
Yes.
You know, I don't care where it was, I was requested, do the Lone Ranger.
That's cute. And then we have another role in
coming. Then, after he met Christ, then you had a show that you put together at the Tropic Showroom.
Where Cheryl's room was.
Yes, at the Hilton Wine Village.
With such a lovely
That
time.
Was a good, fun show.
That was a fun show.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You.
Wasn't that with the Samoan brothers?
That was the second one. The first one was with everybody.
Yeah.
All of the entertainers I could get in.
It was so much
Alfredo
fun.
Alfredo Romero.
Alex McGangas. And I had everybody I could
Island
figure.
Island Breeze.
Yeah.
Come into that show. You want to roll that?
Okay, here we go.
Live, come on!
Young man, that was splendido. Hallelujah.
Splendido.
Splendido. We're in Charo's room here tonight.
Right.
Chito, Dito. Tell me something. Since you have been in these islands, you've been called the giant of entertainment. But now I call you God's gentle giant. You're a minister of the gospel. Tell me, how did the light of Jesus Christ change that great giant of entertainment into the gentle giant of God?
15 years ago, I was out in the streets. Maybe almost 25 years ago, I should say. Cocaine was my preferred drug. My wife at the time says, you know, we're going to pray you into the kingdom. So she went and hung out with you guys. And And just like Scripture says, I became like you.
But it wasn't easy. You gave me a rough time, young man.
Well, I remember the spirit of the Satan just being all over me. So when I saw Phyllis coming, she was going to minister to me, I put her through some trips. And I said, it was like Satan looking at her saying, come on in.
Yeah.
But the Lord changed my life. I got saved on that day with Donnie Johnson. I'll never forget his name forever. And I remember him preaching, and remember how excited he used to get? He used to jump on tables and on chairs and run around the room. Yeah. And he had a red flag in his pocket, and every time he would say something really wonderful, he'd whip out this flag and wave it around, and everybody would say, amen!
Amen.
And I said, I like this guy. This guy is show business.
What I want to know is, do you get up on the table with a flag now?
Well, I'll tell you what, something was just mentioned about me being down at the River of Life Mission, and the thing they never forgot about me being there is me jumping up on the table.
So you're still table hopping for the Lord.
Oh, still table hopping.
And you're filled with the living waters instead
glory.
Of wine.
Somebody say
hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I want to thank you so much, young man, for being a part of my life.
Well, I thank you for opening up that door, you know, because if it wasn't for your perseverance with all those people you had under your wing, nobody would be praying.
Praise God.
I remember Donnie Johnson looking out there, and he went saying something really strange, and he called about shopping, and I went, whoa, what is this? And he says, God spoke to me, and I said, that's good. I like that. Nobody's going to say, no, God didn't speak to you. But then he said, God spoke to me, and he said, there's one of you here that's going to be saved today. He says, today is your day. This is your day of salvation. And he said, you! And I was the only you in that area. You ever been there? You know what I'm talking about? All of a sudden, I found my feet stepping and going down the front of the people. There were 50 people at that Bible study.
Right, and they took you to the prayer of salvation, and then I got you, and I said, for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, in sickness and health, so help you God.
And she says, you'll be heard like a shot around the world.
Amen. And that cannon, it hasn't taken off yet.
Amen. Do I remember that? Do I remember that? That hairdo is horrible. I'm almost as bad now, but I got that same dress. Anyway, we had a lot of fun. And you, I had a little excerpts out of my book that is in my book about
what
you.
What's that book? What book are you referring
it's
to?
It's a book that says, hey, aren't you that lady on TV? And I've written about Debbie Takushi. I've written about you, Leora Himes, Irmgard, all these different ones that I knew, little stories that I, Frank Deal. And I want to read what I wrote about your Judy Jensen is this kind of my personal side of seeing, all right? As Dick Jensen found Jesus at Lord at the Cook's house, the Cook's house was really on fire. That was Howard and Darcy Cook, and they're still on fire for the Lord. It was there that I met Judy Jensen, then Dick's wife. As she shared her plight with me in my car of how Dick was contemplating suicide. I don't know if you knew this. We prayed hard. Dear Lord, save him from this feverish plan. Dick, your car had just been seized a couple of years ago, and you were really in a quandary. You weren't happy about what was going to happen or going on. Dick's heart and mind were in deep depression. I saw Judy's deep hurt and concern as she sat next to me, wringing her hands above her white tennis outfit. Next, the whole prayer group prayed intensely for Dick's conversion. Then that's when I went back into the group, into Howard and Darcy's house. We prayed for Dick, that he would be converted.
That's what they call the hit list.
God's hit list.
When you have a group of Christians sitting around thinking of who we're going to pray for next, you get put on the hit list.
We knew it was you.
Yeah.
They sent me out to see him in the neighbor's backyard patio where he sat sunning himself. I met Dick and waited for God's right timing to speak a few words from the Holy Spirit. But Dick knew what I was about and gave me one hard time. I was following him as he bounced from lawn chair to lawn chair. to keep from being spirit hit by my words. I went away discouraged.
We were at Glenn Larson's house.
Next door,
the
yeah.
producer for television. And he was a strong Mormon. And when I saw them coming, I said, watch this. I'm going to put her through a trip. And she came walking, and I did everything I could possibly do to get her away from me. And she would not give up. She kept coming and kept coming.
I used to come and sit down wherever you go. You didn't know I had that much prayer power behind me, but I went away discouraged. It'll make you happy to know that. But God got Dick curiosity, and one day, January 12, 1983, there he was sitting on a chair in the cook's house.
At the back of the cook's house. I wasn't about to let anybody see me with these crazy Christian people.
However, if Colleen had not seen you at one of those meetings where she came and she wasn't saved yet, she felt very uneasy like you and she wanted to stay in the back. But when she saw you, she said, oh, Dick Jensen's here, so it's okay. Yeah. So you blessed her. That was before she got saved, all right? There he was sitting in the chair in the cook's home, most wonderfully appropriate. We had a great, jumping, lively Pentecostal preacher who waved a red flag when
Donnie
he wanted
Johnson.
when he wanted an amen from our crowd, and this intrigued Dick.
Yeah, that's why you just saw that thing. I said, this guy was showbizing. You know, and I said, he hit me where I was. And that's what how God will do things. He will hit you right where you're at. So if you're still wondering, gee, how come I haven't heard from God? He's still not finished. The work that he had begun in you, he will bring to fruition.
And you're on God's hit list. You're on God's hit list. Somebody's praying for you, a mother, a father, sister, brother, uncle, aunt, wife, the whole kit and caboodle are praying for you.
Yes.
All right. Dick loved Donnie's theatrics. And then came the moment we all held our breath. Because we were all waiting, see? We were all excited that Dick was here. We wanted to see what was going to happen. We held our breath as evangelist Donnie Johnson pointed towards Dick's side of the room and said, you, and as Dick said, I was the only you there. You need to be saved. Come up here. And Dick came up. I have never in my life seen a preacher do this before. But he gave Dick, he began to prophesy over Dick, and he gave him all the gifts and the callings first before you got saved.
Yeah.
That's the second time maybe I've seen that done. But in all of my years of prophecy, 50 years, I've never seen that done. You need to be saved, come up here. And he told him all about, and just before Dick got saved, and it worked though. And the precious Holy Spirit through Donnie Johnson brought Dick through to God while all of us were crying, tears overflowing.
Buckets.
Mouths praising God over his saving grace over Dick Jensen.
Oh, my goodness. What a blessing.
We were all just awed at God's beautiful spirit of coming through Donnie Johnson to bring you to the Lord. We couldn't have asked for better. God did that.
What had happened, too, as I was walking, I don't know why I was walking towards Donnie Johnson, and Phyllis was right next to him. All I know is that I was getting up out of my seat. I don't know what was drawing me. I don't know, except that be the Spirit of God. And as I got to walking to him, I was about 10 feet away from him, and I hit the floor. And all I know is that I turned over on my back and I looked up. There were people all around me just weeping and weeping, praising God.
Wow.
And that's when I got up off the floor and said to you, want to accept the Lord Jesus Christ? And the first thing out of my mouth was, Koraba Sindoro Boheshina. I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. And all of a sudden, everybody was cheering.
Oh, my goodness.
And she stepped up and he said, and the Lord will anoint you because he has called you. You shall be heard like a gunshot around the world.
Right.
That's a prophecy to me.
Amen. I wondered when I gave that to you because we want to remember that.
Did she say gun?
You shall be heard like a gunshot.
It wasn't a cannon, it was a gun.
Gunshot.
Good, okay. And so I gently walked up, after this all happened, I gently walked up as the Spirit led and said, do you, Dick Jensen, take Jesus as your Lord and Savior from this day forward? And you said, yes. Will you love him in sickness and in health? And you said, yes.
Bless God.
And for richer, for poorer, and you said, yes, it was your wedding day to the Lord. The ceremony was over. Dick was totally wedded to Christ. We all circled around Dick, hugged on him, and all whooped and hollered and ran hugging one another. We were a very happy, unruly, Holy Spirit bunch that day. Well,
but
Dick,
the encouragement about that was they actually saw their prayers being answered.
Yes.
Not only did they pray that God would hear, but prayed that God would answer. And when they saw me come into the fold, they said that they were praying to a God that answers prayer.
And boy. What?
Answers prayer.
And boy, does he answer.
What an entrance. Because you fell forward.
Yeah.
You fell forward on your face.
Yeah.
And then he turned over.
Did you see that?
She said that. Oh, he really? Fell down and then he turned over, so he must have been on his face.
Yeah.
So he was walking and then he
fell down.
He got hit by the Spirit of God, fell on his face, prostrate,
yeah,
and then turned over and received the Lord.
Yeah.
How powerful is that?
How
on
fabulous.
His back.
But here's the thing. The fact is that you're just not aware of what is or what isn't kosher.
Right.
You're just flowing with what is happening.
A river is flowing.
But for me to get him off the floor and start speaking in tongues, man.
That was even before you got saved.
I know. You see what I'm saying? I mean, I'm speaking in a heavenly language, and I don't even know if somebody came up and gave me the acceptance of Christ, you know?
And that's
that
what happens,
exciting.
You know. You weren't following the old, good old Pentecostal holiness rules.
Step
God
one,
did what
step
he
two,
wanted to do.
Step three.
And he knew you were a giant of a man, that you had to almost fall on your face before God,
yeah,
to feel,
yeah,
the power of God.
Absolutely.
He knew you loved that.
Yeah.
But he was also such a man of excellence that God just, he just went for it even before he knew.
As I was saying, I didn't know why,
right,
I was going. You hear what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah.
I didn't know what procedure was. All I know is that a spirit was moving me to go towards Donnie, mm-hmm, and Phyllis.
The power of God.
Yeah.
Far ahead of your time.
I want to move on because we've got so much good,
okay,
stuff,
yes,
to talk. Well, Dick went on full steam ahead, fast. I studied up on God's word before he came in because he knew he had questions, hundreds of them, and he would ask me, and I wasn't as smart as he was. I recall Dick calling me that very afternoon of the morning he got saved. I don't know if you remember this, Dick. He said,
yep,
Phyllis, Habitat called me and asked
Habilitat, yeah,
thank,
yeah,
you. Habilitat called me and asked me to speak against drugs at 4 this afternoon. Should I go? And I said, yes, you go, even though I knew he had just gotten freshly saved. The Holy Spirit prompted my words, go. And he blessed those island kids that day, and the Lord continued to use him to speak in our schools program to say no to drugs from then on. He did such a wonderful job, and that fact came out the day Dick went to court, and he stood to receive judgment. Again, the court was full of Christians. But first, I don't know, Colleen, if they know why. In your biography, Dick went to court. If you'd like to just read a little bit of that. Then we'll continue on.
Okay. However, on May 28, 1981, the front page of the Honolulu Advertiser referred to Dick this way. Jensen car seizure tied to show business drug case. A devastating blow that led Dick to the brink of suicide. suicide. No formal charges were brought against Dick in 1981. However, the agonizing fear of being arrested haunted him daily over the next 2 years. During this time, the Lord prepared Dick for what was to come. On January 12, 1983, Dick's life was dramatically changed as he attended a home Bible study. And he was born again, and the Lord supernaturally delivered him from cigarette smoking, marijuana use, alcoholism, and a 15-year addiction to cocaine.
Now, don't just run over that quickly.
Okay, good. Because the Lord told me to read it slow.
The day he got saved, he was delivered from cigarette smoking. And that's a hard one.
Right.
Marijuana use, alcoholism, and a 15-year-old addiction to cocaine. No easy stuff to get out of, believe me, right, Dick?
Absolutely.
And only Jesus can do it, yeah?
That's why I would say to anybody watching today, you've tried all of your own do-it-yourself ways of getting free, you need to try Jesus Christ.
Yes.
That's the answer. I couldn't have done it, and I know full well, had it not been for Christ changing my life, I would not have been able to defeat that.
Amen.
As quickly as God removed Dick from those bondages, so was Satan quick to launch another attack. This attack took place on Monday, the 11th of July. Dick was indicted and arrested for conspiracy, possession, use, racketeering, and trafficking of cocaine, along with other charges stemming from the 1981 car seizure. With his bail set at $50,000 and a possible 15-year prison term, the Lord displayed his miraculous mercy. Dick was released with a $2,000 fine and a 5-year probation. I wasn't there, but you know how close this is hitting me, because Phyllis prophesied about my son, who's now facing in prison in Mississippi, 17-year stint out there. But she prophesied that the same thing that happened to Dick would happen to him. And he immediately, like you, went and started testifying everywhere of what God did. And she said, well, it's all the cards and all the letters and all the church support delivered you. And I hold on to that hope of the prophesied where we fight the good fight and that my son will be set free too, come his appeal. So we're so tied together. I am in entertainment because of you, because of God, but because of you. I was ignited in my art because of you. And through Phyllis, getting saved through Phyllis and the word prophesied, I'm holding on to my son's hope. It's more than a hope. It's assurance.
Yes.
So.
He did a wonderful job, and that fact came out. You did a wonderful job of rehabilitating not only yourself, but everybody that you could speak to.
Everybody and anyone that would listen.
You're just like Colleen when she got saved. Anyone that she could talk. That's what happens when the Lord loves on you and forgives you all your sins. Yeah. You're so happy to be set free. He did a wonderful job, and that fact came out on the day Dick went to court as he stood to receive judgment. Again, the court was full of Christians holding their breaths, waiting to hear the final judgment, and the judge said,
holding hands and praying while I'm standing before the judge.
And he said, I have so many letters of good reports of Dick's firm dedication to rehabilitate himself. There was also a special letter from our own dear island Christian entertainer Alex McGangas that he read, and the verdict was good. Christians roared and cheered and applauded, grasping hands, holding hands up high with tears flowing down their faces, shouting, God bless you, praise the Lord. The Cook's House Revival community were all present, and the good Judge Martin Pence had to put the gavel down.
They were singing.
Were we?
The audience was singing, and that's when Judge Martin Pence began to pound his gavel. because everyone in the courtroom was singing, "This is the day, this is the..." He said, "There shall be no singing in this courtroom."
He says, "This is a court of law," which only drew more cheers from the Christian community. Now our island general, island giant of entertainment, Dick Jensen, became, as I called him in my TV musical show, Lei of Aloha, our gentle giant man of God. Indeed, this sleeping, gentle, spiritual giant is awake and was awake and freed from the 15-year-old cocaine, marijuana, and alcohol addictions the day he got saved. Praise God. Reverend Dick Jensen, I said it right, Reverend is today a beloved pastor of his church called the True Spirit of Aloha. He studied under Pastor Mel Smizer for many years, and he proved himself to be a true gentle giant in God. Thank you, Mel, Pastor Mel, for your great influence too. And thank you, Dick, for being my friend. And yes, someday your life and ministry will be like a shot heard around the world as prophesied in God's timing. And at this present time, Dick is back in the entertaining community. That was way back, the entertaining community, to sing. Go forth, Dick Jensen. God gave you a great talent to bring souls into his kingdom.
God can do anything. God can touch your heart and cause you to change. Trust in him.
What happened, Dick, lately? I hadn't seen you for many, many years. What happened? I know you've got married to your beautiful wife, Tony.
That's her. Hi, Tony.
Lovely wife.
And we also have a child, a four-legged child.
Come on, four-legged.
Yeah, four-legged child. His name is Ikaika.
Because he crawls on the floor, he's four-legged.
He's 10 weeks old. He's a lapsa opso. Puppy.
Adorable.
Yeah, and he looked like one of those Ewoks. That's a new kid in the house.
He's so darling.
But I believe that my wife, Tony, decided that she would get that dog as sort of a help for me in keeping me company, etc. For those of you that have not already heard, I have been diagnosed with Lou Gehrig's disease. It is it has no cure, and they gave me 3 years to live, 3 to 6 years to live, and that time began back in 2002. So November is supposed to be my demise. But I stand upon the word of God, and I know, listen to me, I know that the Lord will not allow that to happen to me.
Amen. Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah. So at that time, it was May 19th, I got that report. Last night I shared with Colleen that whose report will you believe? Whose report will I believe? And I began to find the scripture that'll tell me when God is speaking to me. And I gave her one found in 2 Kings 19. Actually, it's chapter 18 and 19, but then the 19th chapter, verses 14 through 21, clearly states that a change can happen if you listen to what Scripture has already said will happen. Hezekiah received note from the messenger saying they're going to destroy Jerusalem. And Hezekiah said, "That's your report. Now listen to the report of the Lord." And he pulled out all the documents that came in the message and laid them out before the Lord at the temple and said, "Lord, look at your word. First, look at the word that these guys are saying. Secondly, look at what your word is saying." And I put those things down and said, "I'm asking you to do what you do. Forget about what these guys have said, because according to us, I look at me I see my leg doesn't work. I see my arm doesn't work. I see it. But that is in this realm.
Right.
And the Lord says, trust in me because it's already been confirmed in heaven.
Yes.
What's been confirmed? My word.
Yes.
Confirmed in heaven. So I stood there and I said, well, look at this. I'm going to stand on this and put this before God. Many of you right now are looking and you can hear my voice. I'm talking through a nasally path. It's because that's one of the symptoms of the ALS. So when I say to you that no matter what this is outwardly, I can tell you that there is something that happened in this realm that I need to focus on and you need to focus on. Find the Word of God. Hold on to it. That's what God is speaking. On your behalf, the Word says, I'm your son. Hold on to that which is true. And he said, for I will restore your son from the land of the enemy.
Yes.
Amen.
Prophetic word.
Thank you.
We stand with you. I myself have fought against cancer of the breast, and I've had 6 lumpectomies. But I'm standing just like you, that God has a job for us to do, and we're not through yet, Dick Jensen.
No, not yet.
Jick Denson, we're not through yet.
Jick Denson is not finished. Yeah.
And we're going to live to be ripe old ages, and you're going to be healed by the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want every one of you out there who know and love, and even you don't know, Dick Jensen, and you love him. As I pray, I want you to reach forth your hand towards the television and pray the prayer of faith with me for her son, for myself, for my good friend, for the healing of the hearts and the bodies and the spirits and the souls in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you, God, for a perfect healing over Dick Jensen and Phyllis Ramia and Colleen Nomura's son. We thank you, Lord God, that you are a wonderful God, that you love us so much, that you heal us body, soul, spirit, and mind. And I thank you, Lord God, that his limbs and his legs will be again like they were over here where he was singing and dancing. And here he was, this handsome man, this guy that I met in the beginning. And that your voice will come back and you will sing and you will be not the Lone Ranger again, because you're never alone. God is with the Lone Ranger.
Hallelujah.
And I thank you, Lord God, for raising him up, as it were, even from the dead, as it were, from that dead diagnosis. We thank you, Lord, that you are a life, and that abundant life is in all of us now, Lord, and in you. You've had a verdict. Somebody said to you, you're gloomed, you're doomed, you're full of Satan's gloom and doom, and you're going to pass away. That's a lie. Amen. We have been delivered and rescued out of the gloom and the doom of Satan's kingdom and brought into the kingdom of our own dear son, Jesus, God's son, dear Jesus Christ, who bought us with his blood and forgave us all of our sins. And you know, it's as easy to get healed as it is to get saved, Dick. I heard that on Benny Hinn's show. It's as easy to get healed as it is to get saved. But you and I are standing on this word, by his stripes we are healed. He sent his word to us, and it healed us. And you, my young man, look at me. You are the good guy. You are the hot shot that's going to be heard around this world. If it was prophesied to you 22 years ago, then God meant it. It wasn't Phyllis who told you that.
Wow.
It was the Spirit of God. You don't have to go flat on your face this time to find the Lord. Pastor Reverend Dick Jensen, you are God's man, and this is God's timing. And we thank the Lord Jesus Christ right now. When you ask, when 2 or 3 agree is touching anything or anyone, they get what they ask for.
Yes.
And when you ask, ask believing.
Yes.
And you out there who are in a sick room or a hurting state, and you're going through whatever Dick has gone through in his early years of the drugs and now what he's going through, God loves you. And he's going to come into your life as never before, and he's going to raise you up to be a man of God, just like he raised Dick up. And he's going to raise you up out of that sick bed. And he's going to raise you up to do the perfect will of God. Now, Dick Jensen, we have not fulfilled or finished our destiny yet here on this earth.
No, we've not.
We've got a lot of work to do. I'd like to make an appointment with you for a song and a dance. This is the light. What is that you used to sing when you came on my show? The Light of Christ. There was a song.
Jesus is the light.
Do you remember that? You sang it over and over and over. Jesus is the light. Jesus is the life. Jesus is our healing. He's our abundant life. He said, I would that you have life, but that more abundantly.
Amen.
Can I get you on the... Can I book you on our next show?
Can we book that in?
And listen, this ain't the swamp over here. And this ain't the dome. And this is not Charo's room. This is Heartlight. This is God's place. Yeah. And you are the light of God's heart. He's not going to let that light go out.
No, I don't believe that.
And your testimony of your healing will be heard like a shot around the world.
Absolutely.
That is what I prophesied to you weeks ago out in the hall as you were standing and then sitting. And the Lord said that shot around the world is yet to come.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. You got to be alive to shoot off your mouth to sing, girl, a boy. Yeah?
There it is.
And I'm always shooting off my mouth. Hey, thank you.
There's one more testimony.
One more testimony, but thank you for praying for him. Keep him on God's list, will you? To keep praying every day. Say, oh, by the way, God, heal Dick Jensen. Heal Dick Jensen. By the way, God, do that.
Yes.
Because that's what the people did for Jan Crouch.
Sunday, June 12th, my daughter Jennifer has a heart failure, enters the hospital in a coma. Her husband, Ulysses, leaves a message on my cell phone regarding her condition. I don't hear my message until Tuesday, June 4th. Monday, June 13th, her husband, Ulysses, is told by the hospital clergy to get my daughter's things in order. June 14th, I sent first set of emails asking friends and family to pray for my daughter. The email response is such a blessing, and everyone sends words and prayers of encouragement. My dad, brother, sister-in-law, also a nurse, visit my daughter in the hospital. They choose not to tell me how bad she looked. I speak to Ulysses at home, instruct them to take Jennifer's mother and daughter to the hospital. I ask them to join in, use the cell speakerphone to allow my daughter to hear my voice and for me to hear their respondent as I pray for my daughter. Family and nurses can be heard in the background clapping and cheering, and my granddaughter is shouting, she's opening her eyes. She continues to tell Grandpa, her eyes are open, tears are rolling down her cheeks, and she's smiling. More prayers Wednesday, more cheers Thursday. Doctors remove the tubes from her throat. I speak to my daughter by phone. Again, she whispers, I love you, Dad. Friday, the 17th, Tony and I arrive in Vegas at the hospital. My heart is overwhelmed. When I see her, she looks pretty beat up. But the Lord is looking, and I know, because here she has a short memory problem, and she's sitting up in a chair and eating a liquid diet. Praise God. Visit with Jennifer the next day. She continues to improve. We continue to pray and give thanks. God is faithful. Sunday, June 19th, Father's Day, Jennifer is back. She still has some memory problem, but back as spunky as ever. Doctors agree and suggest she should check her heart and have an angiogram and also an MRI for her brain because of the memory loss. Monday, June 20th, Jennifer decides she doesn't want the angiogram. I manage to convince her regarding the need to be tested. Tuesday, we return to Hawaii. No update from Vegas. Wednesday, we receive a report. The angiogram showed no heart damage, and the MRI showed no brain damage.
Praise God.
Thursday, June 23rd, I receive a call from my daughter. She sounds great, very articulate, and strong. 5 days pass, no word. Tuesday, I call to find out how my daughter is doing. My 18-year-old granddaughter, Taylor, answers the phone. She tells me tell me her mother is at work.
Hallelujah.
From say what at work?
30 seconds.
30 seconds,
oh,
Dick.
Man.
She winds it up. The bottom line is, if you shall believe in the word of God and believe in the word of prayer,
yes,
it never returns void.
Yes.
Amen. It never returns void, and we stand together with
yes.
you
yes.
to undergird you in whatever your prayers are. Send them in.
Yes.
Send it in so we can pray for you.
Yes.
Amen.
God bless you.
God bless you. We all say goodbye now. You know what? This has been a special show. Thank you, Dick.
Thank you.
Thank you, Cooley. Much more is good ahead of all of us. Keep talking about Jesus and his wonderful miracles, and we're going to praise God and thank God and wave goodbye to you.